Hello.
Hello.
So, how many people are here for a panel about things you play on your Xbox or PC? Okay, you guys can go. It's cool. Everybody else bust out your 12-sided die. You're gonna need it. Alright, so my name is Luke. I make games. This is Adam and Sage. They also make games. Adam and Sage recently won a very prestigious award for a game they made. But to PAX's credit, they gave us this panel before they knew about that award.
PAX liked us before we were cool.
They're all such trendsetters.
So we're going to talk to you about modernizing fantasy RPGs, and by RPGs we do mean the true variety, the pen and paper variety. And RPGs, and by RPGs we mean Dungeons & Dragons, because there's Dungeons & Dragons, and then, I mean, have there...
And there's other editions of Dungeons & Dragons.
Right, I forgot about that, because I'm too old school. I mean, actually, I never even played Dungeons & Dragons.
I played it once, it was terrible.
Yeah, it's the worst game.
He DM'd it for me, and it was bad.
Yeah, so we're just going to make up some games right now.
To talk about that.
So in order to take you on our journey... Oh my, who's crying? It's okay. we really have played D&D before, it's okay.
I played it yesterday, I promise.
So in order to take you on our journey from to the future, we need to start in the past. Oh, and by the way, does anyone need ASL? There is an interpreter up here, and it is rad.
We've also given him permission to go off script, so if you want to know like sports scores or something, you can probably do that.
So we're going to do a little bit of history of the hobby, the medium, the form, and then we're going to talk a little bit about our own takes on the hobby and fantasy RPGs, and we're going to talk a little bit about concepts involved in modern RPGs and modern fantasy RPGs, and then we're going to blow your minds. Alright, so our hobby is rooted in fantasy, it is undeniable, and in a particular brand of fantasy. Yes!
Somebody figured out it was not a Skyrim panel. I learned from Skyrim.
So our hobby is also rooted in being snarky jerks. our hobby there are really two branches that come together in 72, 73, 74 to create the world in which you now live, and one of them is pulp fantasy fiction. The creators of Dungeons & Dragons love this shit with an unholy passion. Also, I guess I'd like to just point out that we are not going to talk about the war game aspect because it's just...
We've only got an hour.
We've only got an hour, right. And this is also not a history lesson. You want to,
This isn't a history lesson. This is us setting up the information that we need to talk about other stuff. Like, if we're going to talk about modernizing, we need to know where we're starting from. So we're skipping over huge, important things. I will plug this awesome book, Plane of the World, if you want to know more of this stuff. It's fantastic. It'll take you forever to read, but it's totally worth it. But we're just going to give you, John Peterson.
So yeah, if you would like an academic and beautiful history of the hobby, Plane of the World by John Peterson is worth your time. It's one of the best books I've ever read.
And we're just going to skip over high points to hit the things that we want to talk about.
So this is where we started, but many of you probably haven't read some or all of these.
Yeah, as a sort of personal aside, like I hadn't read any of the Appendix N stuff until maybe 2 years ago. And it's great. So if there's anyone who thinks that D&D, even the earliest versions of D&D, are original creations of any kind, read any of these books. Like, it's all stolen like crazy.
Yeah.
And it
it sets up the hobby in an interesting way, because there's a lot of, especially as RPGs develop, there are a lot of people, they're like, oh, well, you stole this from that game, or you stole this from that movie or TV show, but there's no beginning to that. Like, it's been happening forever.
And there's a lot of canonicalization. So these books will have some drastically different takes on, like, the usage of the word orc, for example. And there are so many things that were orcs, and we end up boiling down into one of those. And that's the interesting starting point, that we start from a huge swath, and each game kind of picks out things from that.
If you haven't read it and you want to see how to do a perfect game with chaotic evil PCs, read anything with Kugel in it. Mm-hmm. He's an asshole like crazy, and it's so fun.
That's the eyes of the overworld there. Yeah. Anyway, but it's been 40 years. Most, if not all, of these fellows are dead. Many of these books are out of print. So. It's been 40 years. Things have changed. Our conception of fantasy has changed. Our conception of ourselves has changed. I love this, though. I can't help but think this is deliberate, that this is Peter Jackson referring to Rankin and Bass. But look at the dark mirror that Peter Jackson is looking through. I mean, look at how much more sinister our current conception of fantasy is than the kind of innocent children's book feel of the Rankin and Bass cartoon. Just blows my mind. Even though our fantasy has these roots, we are constantly churning through them and constantly reassessing them. That is the original stick-on cover for the white box for D&D that Gary and Dave slapped on the wood grain box and sent out to everybody. And this is the latest piece of D&D Next promo art. Like, it's you have a hastily sketched pen and ink of a wizard blasting some sort of troglodyte, and then this museum piece. But it's just the emotional level, and honestly, the darkness of it are just wildly different. Things have changed.
The curious thing that I find here is that the piece on the right, the D&D Next piece, somehow they're trying to make that like a hopeful thing, like he's gonna kill that dragon. And I look at it, I'm like, this guy is.
Run, buddy. Get out of there.
Yeah. So D&D Next is, of course, kind of like a current that runs through this, because if we're talking about modernizing RPGs, we're talking about modernizing D&D to some degree, and of course Wizards is doing that as well. So we're not going to like tell them what they should do. That's not our thing, but we're on the same path, where they're doing the same things, dealing with the same developments that we are, and it's interesting to see.
So things have changed. We can't help but look at how things changed in this regard. So the Gore series by John Norman. I recently talked to John Peterson, who is the current scholar on the history of the hobby, the author of that book, and he told me that there's growing evidence that more and more stuff is coming out of the woodwork that Gary was a huge fan of the Gore series by John Norman. So just to dwell on this a moment, I unfortunately, due to technical difficulty, I don't have access to my notes, but the quote that I was going to read you just has the narrator of I think the third book. This is the cover of the second book. It's the narrator of the third book, Tarl Cabot, who has been transported from his land into this fantasy world, describing to the slave girl why she loves to be dominated by men. And it's not the taste of the whip, it's the sheer domination by a man. It's submitting to a man. And there are, there are 39 of these fucking books. pardon me for a moment. Whoa. It's like a cast of cantrips in there. All right, so thanks. allow me to not use P's. To look at the cover of the John Norman book, where you have the aloof Tarl Cabot in the background, the dark, swarthy foreign figure threatening the woman, and the supplicant enchained woman in the foreground. I mean, it's a very masculine, very powerful, but I mean, he doesn't look like he cares. And the woman is, it's completely sexualized. Like her hindquarters are lifted, you know, in quivering anticipation of the punishment she's going to receive. It's awful. It is awful.
It's also not physically possible.
No. But it's something to consider that this had an influence on early D&D. Not that Gary and Dave were assholes and believe this. I mean, there were lots of women who were very influential players and playtesters early on. But let's look at Brienne. Like, I chose these two images, or these three images, really, very, very deliberately. And so Brienne is in the same position as Tarl Cabot in these images. She is the one who is aloof, and in this case, disgusted by Jaime, but protective of him in this case. She is ennobled, she's powerful, though, even though she doesn't like the person that she's come to protect, and even though he's trying to sexualize her, she is telling him of a new way, a new order. And I just think it's really indicative of where we've come in our perception, of fantasy and the hobby.
Yeah, the thing to take away, I think, is that the fantasy RPGs have, since their earliest inception, been a product of the pop cultural space that they exist in. There's no game, or whether it's a tabletop game, a board game, a computer game, there's no game that exists independent of that cultural space, both for the positive and negative of the space that they're coming from.
And just a final note on that, Michael Moorcock basically said about John Norman's books, like, maybe people shouldn't read these. anyway, so to back up a little bit, we need to address now some core points about what comprises the text. So, want to talk a little about this? Want to do this one? I feel like I talked a lot.
Sure. Or
head sage.
Okay. So these are the three original books: Monsters and Treasure, An Underworld? I forget the first word. Something in Underworld.
Underworld and Wilderness Adventures.
Underworld and Wilderness and Men and Magic. And these comprise the text of D&D. They're not really a complete game in and of themselves. They reference Chainmail for key procedures. Chainmail being Gygax's earlier tabletop war game. And they, Overworld stuff actually references another game published by
Avalon Hill.
Yeah, you couldn't play D&D without buying a different board game by another company.
And buying a different
tabletop war game. Think about that for a second. Like, there's no way that a company now would release a game and say, okay, here's 80% of the game, but if you want to play it, go buy Monopoly. I mean, unless you're Epi and you made Dread, but it's a whole.
These books contain more or less all you need to play D&D. They are unclear on several points. Like, even the things that they try to explain, you have to kind of fill it in from later editions and kind of guess, like, oh, that's probably what they intended, but the actual wording, you can pick it apart endlessly. It's not clear. We don't know what some of these things were intended to be. And this is actually a really unfortunate thing in our hobby. We don't have, like, video footage of some of these earlier D&D games. Like, we don't know how the game was played. We have stories that are passed down, but everybody's recollection is always going to be their recollection. Like, they're going to remember things differently than they happened. So we don't have, like, absolute ideas of how this played, but we have a text. Let's see, what key points do we want to talk about here?
So despite the problematic nature of these three books, they do present us with the very core of our modern world. They present us, right, hit points, armor class, saving throws, done, end of hobby. This is the game we're all playing right now.
You've got spells.
Who's not playing D&D right now? Right? Like, right now, who's not making a saving throw against this panel right now? obviously there is more to D&D than this. I mean, there are other tropes here that the innovations that they presented, levels and experience points, persistence of character, are some huge ones. It had a particular and peculiar magic system. What else? What No.
I was going to say, the total lack of skill system indicates what the game is about just by looking at the character sheet. I mean, there's no question if your characters are going to need to be good at basket weaving, because no one cares. Basket weaving is not about what the game is about. So the tools that, D&D gave you in its initial form were literally the tools that the designers felt that you needed to play the game. The rest of the rules were on the GM, just to make up as they went along.
An interesting thing to note there is that that does include like a social mechanism in the reaction roll. Like people like say, "Oh, it's all fighting," but if you can get an awesome reaction roll modifier, like that is the path to success. Charisma is totally not the dump stat.
Yeah, charisma's the
booze stat. So, but what's also really interesting is it. Despite how thin the character sheet is and how sketchy the rules were and what they're offering, the idea was so powerful and so compelling, it just swept the whole hobby off its feet. It was the magic moment of its day. That's capital M magic. Then that's it, right? We're done, right?
Yeah, this is the D&D everybody's playing, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right, and so 30 years later, these guys make Dungeon World, and that was the next fantasy game to come out, right? Right, or maybe 2003, some other game with two books or something.
This game with vampires in it, maybe?
Yeah, maybe. Yeah,
I think so.
Right? So you've done... Well, so as it turns out, as I said, the idea was so powerful that it left a crater in the hobby, and people immediately, not 30 years later, not 10 years later, immediately saw the potential for it and other shit that it should be doing. Chivalry and Sorcery was, according to John Peterson, if I remember correctly, was first out of the gate as a D&D fixer.
Which is interesting, because D&D had, at that point, like hundreds of copies in circulation, maybe? That's not...
1977, it was starting to blow up. This is 3 years later. It was in blow-up mode.
Okay.
It was the first year and a half, I think, where they were like, right, they just...
Yeah, the first year and a half, they had like hundreds of copies.
Right. So, the really funny story about Chivalry and Sorcery is that when it came out, everyone was like, yeah, realism, there are all these reviews, like, this is the most realistic role-playing game ever, finally, no more D&D, we're going to play Chivalry and Sorcery. And then, months later, these guys would write in, because they instead of posting on forums, they communicated to each other through zines and newsletters. They write in the newsletters, like a little contrite, like, it's unplayable. It's horrible.
Flame wars occurred at a glacier's pace. Like, lol, no, you wrong. 6 months later, no, you.
The best part is they still existed. Like, you read some of the early reviews of D&D, and they're scathing from wargamers who are like,
I haven't played this, but it's terrible.
Exactly. It's already happening. And all of us have gotten those reviews, too. Like,
it's
this
going
is
to kill
constant.
Gaming forever.
Yep. It destroys wargaming.
So, right. And Chivalry and Sorcery is not the only early entrant into the race. So, 1978, RuneQuest, Ross Trinity and Greg Stafford, kind of behind the scenes, his great eminence there. Right, and so 1978, here, we fixed it, finally. We have skills, levelless advancement, no more Vancian magic, we have spellpoint magic, and we have this really cool setting.
Like, yeah, also ducks.
And
ducks.
Right, playable ducks.
Duckman. That's an interesting thing about the Wenatha here, is that it, more so than D&D's kind of vaguely implied cesspool of pop culture stuff, has a very clear idea of what it is and some probably not entirely unprecedented, but relatively unique ideas.
Yeah, setting as a selling point for a game, this is sort of where that started, where you're buying in as much for the fictional space
hunt.
You're going to... The Duck Hunt, exactly. You're buying in as much for the fictional space as for the rules.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny. Gary and Gabe both had their own settings for D&D, but they chose to leave them out in order to make the game more accessible, which obviously was a smart thing to do. I also really like the cover for RuneQuest. It is, it's a powerful lady fighting off the iguana.
Is this like a trend in covers that everybody's doomed on covers?
Yeah.
Like,
this is what will happen to your character.
I give her a better shot than the dude versus the dragon.
Oh yeah, totally. Yeah, better shot, but like, it's never the adventure being triumphant.
You gotta have a compelling narrative to get people involved. So then jump forward. I mean, there's many steps along this path, but especially many D&D steps. But D&D pretty much ruled the world, despite RuneQuest. And even, I mean, we skipped over Tunnels and Trolls, because why not? But we arrive at this point here where Mark Reinhagen starts to break out of D&D.
Reinhagen?
It's just Mark Reinhagen. Thank you. you want to talk a little bit about this?
Yeah, I mean, Vampire is an interesting example. I don't have a lot of experience with Ars Magica, so I'm gonna leave that one to someone else. But with Vampire and the subsequent games that came along with it, we start to see this idea of story as a thing. That the game isn't about necessarily the characters doing stuff. It's about the story that emerges from that. You know, there's some mechanisms around role-playing and around the way that the characters are meant to be a vessel for this big epic story that you're telling as a group. And while the text focused really heavily on that, the rules still weren't necessarily able to back that up. I mean, what you essentially got was a superhero game about vampires.
Awesome. A superhero game.
Right. I mean, the rules definitely tried to aim for emotional content, and certainly the setup of the game with your clans and the look and the feel of it. I mean, it was groundbreaking in its day. But yeah, as Adam mentioned, it doesn't quite hit. Ars Magica, Mark's game before that, took on D&D directly, and it's innovative from the fact you all play wizards, and it has a really fantastic magic system.
Trooper style play.
Troop style, right? You're changing characters?
Yeah, you have multiple characters, and instead of those characters being like a herd of people that you're going to throw into a dungeon and some of them are going to survive, it's actually people that are going to rotate through, and all of them are to some degree yours.
Right. So, but I need to take a step back, though, in time, and we need to talk about 1985. Because to my eye, this is the first modern RPG. This is a proto-modern RPG. This is a game called King Arthur Pendragon by Greg Stafford, and this game is ridiculous. It is so tightly designed. It is exactly what it says on the tin, King Arthur Pendragon. You play a knight in King Arthur's court. You are involved in the Arthurian mythos. You're at Arthurian ground zero. You watch Arthur Pendragon die. There's nothing you can do about it. The metagame is more important than the life of your character. Lets the game take over your character. If you wish your knight to behave in an unjust manner, you have to roll against your justice. And if you succeed, then you act in a just manner. You don't have a choice. It's mind-blowing. It has like a stunting mechanic, a really early stunting mechanic called passions, where you know, if you really care about something, you get to roll for your passion and then get a bonus. Or if you fail, you get a fumble and you go mad.
Whirly bone.
It's meticulously well researched. I mean, it's beyond the pale. Like, it's a PhD worth of research. It's funny. The few places where Pendragon falls down is it's still reactionary to D&D. It's still saying, hey, this is not, it's still saying D&D is dumb. This is how you make it better. Which is not really the greatest standpoint to be in. However, though, if you are looking for a good place to go back and start and play a very deep, beautifully designed game with lots of moving parts, Pendragon is where to go. So I feel like we really start to see a paradigm shift. And also, if you look at modern games, you can almost always trace a line back to some influence from Pendragon.
What's your take on the more recent versions of Pendragon? Just because those people might actually be able to get.
The current edition, I think, is the 5th edition, and it's wonderful.
Okay.
He's kept true to it. The 4th edition, he backed off on being a knight in King Arthur's court, and that's just dumb. Like, that's what he's about.
So, game called King Arthur Pendragon, and you're just going to be some dude.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Don't be a merchant in King Arthur's court. So, right, so then, sun sets on 1991, right, and we reappear 10, 12 years later. This game. So, in the late 90s...
We just kind of skipped ahead here.
Yeah.
Nobody followed us on it.
That's cool. That's cool. So, in the late 90s, I haven't dated this one. Ron Edwards released this game called Sorcerer that's in the lower-hand corner, the supplement Sorcerer and Sword. And Ron Ron tried to cleave to the very heart of what it meant to be fantasy and pulp. He went back to the original source material, and he focused his game on dramatic play and emotional content over skill systems, levels, armor class, hit points, any of that stuff. You start the game as competent. The advancement in the game is simply change, not betterment or worsenment.
So what made Sorcerer so capable, such a powerful experience to play, was that it didn't cleave to, like Luke said, the D&D model of you start off a useless pile of crap, and hopefully someday you're going to be that guy on the parapets fighting the enormous dragon. And it's aspirational play, right? You didn't have to spend 20 sessions to get there. It's just, here's who you are, here's what you're capable of. It's not about advancement, it's about telling stories about these characters. And the mechanisms all speak directly to that goal, as opposed to promising them and then giving you D&D mechanics again.
Right, and it's a testament to Sorcerer's influence that when you look at modern story games and that ilk of like independent RPG, you go back and read Sorcerer, you're like, what's the big deal? Like, I don't get it. Like, this, what's so, like, you know, crazy about this? It's like, you know, it's like watching Citizen Kane now. You're like, whatever, this movie's kind of boring. and it is. It's a little obtuse, it's a little dry, but the, you know, what Ron created there was really important. Then there's this game. So,
you don't need to know anything about this.
Yeah,
no. Next slide.
Let's go to the next slide.
Next slide? Wait, what's the next slide? Oh, wait a minute.
Good stuff's coming out.
Yep.
Wait, all right, like, we're going to take a good long time. How much time do I have?
That slide comprises the entire rest of the presentation.
So anyway, in Burning Wheel, what I, oblivious to what Ron was doing, but around the same time, I tried to shift the focus of fantasy the focus on the players, to what their goals were in the scenario, to try to move the action forward based up, you know, in reaction to what they want, rather than setting up an opposition for them in the form of a dungeon or a world and having them figure out what to do.
A dungeon or a world.
What? I don't know. Maybe we should go back another slide and talk more about So. And shifting away from in Burning Wheel the D&D paradigm of exploration, loot, and murder what Jake Norwood dubbed blood opera. Though Burning Wheel is a very technical game. There's it's definitely in the realm of RuneQuest and Harn, games like that where it's skill based, levelless, It just, you know, along that paradigm. It's not a reaction to D&D in any way, shape, or form.
Where a lot of games that came before Burning Wheel had sort of loose models for helping you as a player get in the head of your character, because ostensibly, you know, I think that most people believe that role-playing is about thinking as your character would think. What would my character do in this situation? So D&D gave you alignment so you could say, okay, I'm chaotic neutral, so I'm going to do whatever's the most annoying right now. Or Vampire gave you your demeanor and your nature, and so there were some tools, but they're only loosely connected to the mechanism. With Burning Wheel, it's the target in the center of the game. It's like, what do your characters want? How do they approach every problem in their life through this lens of belief? Which makes it, I think, really revelatory for folks who have been looking for that experience in other games, and sort of speaks to the importance of making mechanisms in games that reflect the kind of play that you want at the table. Because, again, not a lot of games prior to Burning Wheel do that, but it's obviously really a focus in this game.
So the belief thing, I had that kind of revelation. I sat down to play Burning Wheel and I made a great
Tell us about your character, Sage.
It's a good example. This is an example. I'm going to tell you about my character was a grave digger. We need to dig up a dead body and necromancy it or something. Yeah, exactly. And I have a belief about the dead must rest in solemn sleep or whatever. Something that a grave digger would be proud of his job. We need to dig up a thing to necromancy. And I'm like, okay, GM, I dig it up. And he's like, oh, really? And I look at my sheet and I wrote down, the dead must sleep, and it turned into actually a huge part of our game, that my gravedigger then fought the necromancer, was another player character, et cetera, et cetera. But, like, there was this moment where I realized this character exists outside of me, and I've created this thing to guide me in playing this character. And it's going to reward me for fulfilling it, and it's going to sometimes get me into trouble, but that trouble is going to be fantastic.
Excellent. So then, so they played a lot of Burning Wheel, and then they made their own game.
That's disturbingly true, actually. But
we only stole like four things from Burning Wheel,
including the Burning Wheel itself. It's a magic item. Do you want to talk about that? We've talked about this a lot.
Yeah, okay. I do it better. So,
yeah,
yeah. I mean, Dungeon World is very much the archetypal exploration, loot, and murder game. Like it's. In short, sort of, it's the way that we remembered D&D minus the rules. You know, I was playing at the time when we were developing, and I was playing a game of first edition AD&D with a bunch of people who'd never played role-playing games before, which is an awesome combination. don't ever do that. But the actual play that we were having at the table, you know, I knew all the rules, and my players didn't and didn't care about them, and they were just telling me, okay, I'm going to do this. You tell me which of these funny dice to roll and then how awesome I am when I'm done rolling it. Which functionally is how Dungeon World works. The players describe their actions. The table as a group decides if those descriptions trigger the mechanisms of the game. You roll, something happens, and you move on. And it hews to the D&D mold. It's about, you know, getting your torches and your swords and going and killing subhumans in the depths of the earth and taking their stuff. It's in a lot of ways it's an homage in play to those early D&D models, the kinds of games that we were playing.
And some of the ways, so first of all, credit where it's due, we're based on a game called Apocalypse World by Vincent Baker, which we stole liberally from. And some of the cool things there, we really...
Moral of the story, if you want to win a bunch of RPG awards, just find a game that everyone already likes, merge it with another game everyone already likes, and then sell it.
Yeah, stick dungeons on it. Yeah. So, the two things up there... The GM toolkit that we provide Vincent provided and we copied and updated, is one of the cool things that has come about out of these games. It's giving the GM an actual, real, direct handle on how to run the game. There's a lot of games out there that kind of say, and then the GM does awesome stuff. Do what makes your players have fun. Which is totally bullshit advice, because how do I know what makes my players have fun? Like, that is an aspiration, not a thing I can do. So we tried to provide actual frameworks, actual things that the GM does moment to moment and on a higher level, and what your goals are, and this is how you GM the game. Partially because it's a great tool to run the game, and partially because then you can change it. There's lots of games that assume some kind of GMing, and you have to figure that out, and then figure out that you want to do something different, whereas we're just going to throw it out there, and you're going to mess with it, you're going to do what you want. And then the other thing is that every role means something. Every result either means you succeed at something, with trouble, or more trouble. The GM gets to say the trouble.
Right, and this kind of mechanism is something we're starting to see a lot more of in RPG design, and have been for a while. It's a term that's starting to get some momentum. It's referred to often as fail forward. The idea that as a player's character attempts an action, the worst possible thing you can do is say, well, nothing happened, so I'll try again. So, you know, again, this is something that is sort of starting to become part of the DNA of modern game design. It used to be just a weird indie thing, but there are games like 13th Age mentions it specifically. So it's starting to really take hold.
And the thing that we, or Vincent did, is build it in so that failing forward is not just a suggestion of GM advice. Like, this is a thing that good GMs do, because don't you want to be a good GM? Why don't we just build that into the game? So instead, it's built into the game. When you fail, things happen, and... yeah, you fail forward.
All right.
We probably talked about it. We talk about this game too much. Like,
game of it's all right. So, all right. So we're moving on. I feel bad that I skipped the 90s. I feel like we should pause a moment and look back. So why didn't we call out like lots of cool fantasy RPGs from the 90s? Well, because the 90s. The 90s was this really weird period in fantasy RPGs where everyone was trying to fix D&D, including D&D. So this is not Complete Cyanix Handbook is 1991, and that really set the tone. I mean, you know, Wizards picked up D&D in the latter half of the decade and began to refine it into its more modern form, more playable form. But yeah, it was a dark time for the Rebel Alliance. Not that there weren't great RPGs being produced, and there were really innovations in the field being done. We were just trying to focus this on the fantasy side of things.
And fantasy just kind of got weird. Like they are putting a new edition of Cinnabar, and I backed it just because like it's this crazy over the top weird thing.
The flying grizzlies with laser eyes.
That's actually a thing.
Which sounds much more awesome than it is. I want that in my game right now.
There is actually one really good piece of art in there of a raccoon with a rocket launcher.
Let's move on.
Yeah, that's the 90s done.
Do not find that game on eBay and buy it and play it, because you will write me and be like, you're right.
Not only did you waste my time, you wasted my money too.
Yeah. That's the end of the history lesson. So we want to now touch on some of the concepts that we talked about and what we think is important to being a modern fantasy RPG. So task versus conflict resolution. So task resolution is the term that we've come up with for the way you resolve shit in D&D. I guess the best way to describe this, I was playing D&D the other night, really, my coworker Nicole was guarding the rear during a fight. They were afraid they were gonna be ambushed, so the combat ends up front, and then they did attract a wandering monster, some hobgoblins, started coming up in the direction that she was guarding from. She heard them, she saw them, she got the drop on them, she was ready for it. I gave her credit for that. So she wanted to use her charisma. She had maybe a 13 charisma or something. So she wanted to use that to try to scare them off. I mean, it's a really powerful mechanic in the game. Anyway, she says run, we're all dead. It's the Ogre Slayer. Referencing something that had happened. The party had killed an ogre in the previous session, and they knew, the hobgoblins knew about it. So it was clever. It was a good ploy. I also knew that these four hobgoblins were really badass. They were cutthroat, and they were looking for trouble. They were looking for the people who killed the ogre. So she rolls, and she succeeds. So in task resolution, it's an interesting decision. She rolls, she succeeds. They are looking for the ogre slayers, so they just charge in and kill her, right? They say, well, that's good that you succeeded, but you succeeded in drawing them toward you. It's weird. It's a very strange moment in that game. But I had this moment where I wrestled with it because I had all this baggage from playing modern RPGs, and I knew what she wanted to do. I knew what she intended to do, which was to scare them off or cause them to delay to allow her group to shift its front. And I granted her that because I'm a jerk, and I couldn't just be the cutthroat GM and be like, yeah, you succeeded in drawing him toward you. So that's part of the difference with task and conflict resolution. We're not talking about, a moment-to-moment resolution versus like a scene resolution or something like that. You're talking about divining intent here resolving a scene based on what you want to happen rather than just simply what action that you're taking.
Yeah, the sort of classical example is of the thief trying to pick a lock, right? The thief's intent is to get into the room or to open the chest, not to pick the lock in and of itself. Conflict-based resolution, you can look at that and you can extrapolate a whole bunch of circumstances around it, Maybe the thief fails, they'll eventually get what they want, but it's going to take twice as long, which means monsters might show up. Or, they get it, but there's something bad in the room. Like, you can extrapolate out from that. But if you're using just task-based, it's like, okay, the only thing that matters is there's a lock, you got picks, let's roll until you succeed. Right? You have to build systems around that, and it tends to create clutch for the game, rather than just looking at the intent of the player.
So, and this image is from James V. West. It's an illustration by him. He designed an RPG called The Pool, which is an early example of a game focused strictly on conflict resolution. He calls it out in the game. All right, so moving on. So a comprehensive system, this is something that we're always looking for when we're looking at a modern RPG. If I go to the Complete Strategist and open up a game and there's rules for magic and combat and that's it, put it back. I'm not interested.
I was about to disagree, but I'll let you make your point.
Go ahead. Disagree with me.
So focus rules can mean that you can have an awesome game of combat and magic, and those things can be fantastic as long as you know that's the game you're making. If you promise a game of, like, intrigue and vast kingdoms at war, and then you give me combat and magic, I'm kind of screwed because I don't have tools for all those other things. So the focus part on the slide there is the what I think is really important. You have the rules for the things that you need to do that game, and you cut all the other crap. Like, for early D&D, you don't need skills. Like, that isn't a thing that you need. You don't need the D20 skill list, because that's not the game that you're playing.
It's worth noting, though, that early D&D gives players and the GM the tools that they need to arbitrate those situations anyway, because, you know, the rule book, like, basic mold there is, like, what, 45, 50 pages long?
64 pages.
Nerds. And like half of that is monsters. So, you know, the other rules are how to make your guy, how to
monsters and spells.
Yeah, hence the right spells. How to make your guy, how to kill stuff with your guy, how to explore things, and then there's a few paragraphs that just say, GM, here's what you can do to arbitrate everything else. Like, everything's got a 1 in 6.
Well, and exactly, that's part of making a comprehensive system. If you give me magic and combat, and you focus me on that thing, and then you tell me, other than that, you make up odds. And it's the example in Moldvay is actually a percentile roll. But it's my favorite part of the game. Yeah, people are always like, oh, Moldvay just tells the GM to do whatever you want. Moldvay tells the GM, assign probabilities to outcomes of events and then roll for them.
Yeah.
Which is a great catch-all way to tell the GM, like, the GM is supposed to judge the fictional situation and be like, well, there's about a 10% chance you're going to just die, 70% chance that you're going to land somewhere halfway down, and, oh man, I have to do math. 20% chance that Sage can't do math.
It's
closer to 100.
So, moving on, just the image on the slide is a character sheet by John Harper for Vincent Baker's game In a Wicked Age, which has an extremely focused system, but has a very expansive setting. It has a beautiful, flowing fantasy setting. So it's not about focusing the game down to do only one thing, it's just focusing on the system. Oops. We lost the GIF when we lost the thing.
This slide is supposed to be really cool.
The slide. Yeah. So, procedures. If any of you are familiar with my games, you know that I'm a fan of procedures. And I think in the modern RPG, the field is so cluttered, and honestly, we have 40 years of history behind us. We're doing it, you know, no one any favors if we don't provide players clear procedures for playing the game. We don't spell it out and teach them how to play the game through the rules text.
Yep, I agree. Let's move on to next slide.
All right, yeah.
We're going to leave some time for questions.
But player agency. Did it again. Cast my snap country. So player agency, this is something, like, basically, as we've come to enjoy these games more and more, we've come to really like our characters, we get mad when they die. How many people have had a character die recently in a game?
I killed some of them yesterday.
So that's a distinct minority in the game. It's just not, character death isn't really a part of the story anymore. We want to see our characters struggle and overcome, and just get by the skin of their teeth. And games, especially in the last 10 years, have really been addressing this through a variety of mechanics.
And the interesting thing there, in Dungeon World, we address this not by... There are quite a few things that make your character longer lived, but we also want to make death be a part of the table. So we say, like, when you die, you make a new character. Like, characters are designed such that a new character into a group of higher-level ones isn't a big deal. Like, one way to... all these things are awesome, and the focus of action can also mean that you just embrace death, and you're like, things die, and we're going to keep on rolling. Adam plays a lot of DCC, which has a character funnel where you start with a whole bunch of characters and just kill off a bunch of them. Like, they start at zero level. The ones who survive are the characters you're going to play.
Right.
Yeah, and I guess that's the difference, right, is that some games choose to mitigate the consequences of death. They give you an out, right? So instead of dying, you can lose some points from your character, or you can lose something that's of value to your character. And then other games have the threat of doom and demise lurking over you the whole time, but they make it so you can jump back in if you die. It's not so much about any individual character, but of the arc of all the characters that you're playing.
Right, and so the example for this one is Trollmaid by Ron Edwards, and where this game is distinctly about the player negotiating the Trollmaid world to get what he or she wants. All right. So Robin Laws is a huge proponent of drama and narrative and story in games, and he designed a game with Greg Stafford. Again, designer of Pendragon and one of the guys behind RuneQuest, so a really big influence on game design. HeroQuest is an evolution of those designs, but now focused on descriptive text, it uses conflict resolution, but the conflict resolution, it very explicitly calls out that you do not set difficulty based on how difficult the action, but on how dramatic the outcome.
Yeah, you see a little bit of that in Dogs in the Vineyard as well, where your character's abilities aren't determined by how good your character is at them. It's how important they are as the player to the character. So I might have blind as a bat as one of my, as one of my traits, but I have a massive pool of dice to use when that trait comes in, because that, to me, helps make the concept of my character better. I want to be able to have more to say about those scenes.
Right.
So I'm the one who put story in quotes originally when we made this slide, and that's because story here is partially like the way that we remember things afterwards. Like some games explicitly aim for creating plot and like, oh, we're going to have rising action, falling action, etc. Some games focus on creating, like, loading up a whole bunch of crazy stuff that can happen, interesting stuff, and then you just play all that out. So story isn't always story like we know the script we're going to go through. Story is also the creation of dramatic stuff that later on we'll remember as like a clear narrative.
Yeah, I'd argue that it's a term that the hobby in general hasn't really figured out yet.
Yeah.
That there's a lot of different ways to interpret what story in a role-playing game is.
Yeah.
All right. And one of the other things I think it's important to point out here at the kind of the end of this arc of like components, modern components to modern role-playing games, is that, you know, Gary and company read a lot of books. It's not that they didn't go to the movies. Ivanhoe is cited as one of the influences on D&D. It's a 1952 piece starring Richard Taylor and Elizabeth Taylor, and it's basically another version of the Robin Hood story. But, you know, we grew up on stuff like Braveheart. Ivanhoe is so innocent compared to this madness. It has affected our designs. You know, our designs are darker, our designs are gorier, but it has also affected our designs into the cinematic influence in that we want to be able to play in 2 or 3 hours now. Like, the thought of sitting down for an 8-hour game is off the table. That's for a variety of reasons, but one of them is because, you know, our story consumption is so cinematic at this point. We want to recreate those experiences.
The other interesting thing here is also comic books as an influence. So Gary called out the comic bookification of some mechanics in games because they were getting over the top and crazy, but I think that has become more of an influence, and of course we've got tons of comic book based games, but the idea of kind of over the top heroics and quick action scenes and splash panels, I think is also, like cinema, infected just the way that we understand gaming and the way that we expect stories to come to us.
All right, so real quick, there's another modernity. There's another arm to the modernity of these games, and we touched on it earlier, and we're gonna touch on it again. Bad touch on it. So this is X8, Drums on Fire Mountain. This probably came out in 85. So While Pendragon was being published, this was the other thing. This was a competition. I don't know which one you'd rather play. I think Sage said to me, he's like, I can't imagine that seeing this published today. That is a racist caricature.
Yeah, the huge afros. And it's crazy because they cut kind of like a crazy mashup of cultures. It's ostensibly supposed to be like a tropical island. And they just seem to have just thrown all kinds of like every stereotype they can into it.
Yeah. And it's not that we're clean from this, but...
Yeah, well, I was going to say, like, this... Like, I worked in a game store during the big D20 glut, and there's a series, and I'm not even going to deign to name it, but there's a series of game supplements whose covers are essentially centerfolds from Playboy with fairy wings spray-painted on them, or Egyptian headdresses, or whatever. So this... And that wasn't that long ago. Like, this kind of thing, this sort of exploitative, especially in art, in role-playing games, isn't something we've fully managed to escape yet. There's still some struggling
right.
around it,
but
for sure.
But we are getting better. So this is Sila. This is a painting by Wayne Reynolds for
Pathfinder.
And she's just awesome. And I mean, she's awesome for a variety of reasons, but also just such a fucking relief not to see a bald white guy in that armor.
It's an excellent alternative to the Space Marine.
So another kind of arm of like the gender thing that's really interesting, there's a game called Sagas of the Icelanders, which deals with gender in a really interesting way. Instead of going with a very like enlightened, you know, the black female paladin, which is great, it's trying to do these Icelandic tales where gender is a real social construct, and to engage with that, the game, instead of pushing it all under the table, has actually some different rules for men and women, but instead of those rules being like the horrible stat modifier.
Yeah, like I promise she doesn't get a minus 2 to strength.
Yeah, she does not get a minus 2 to
strength. She will rip your arms off.
Instead of being that, they're about how society perceives you. So like men, if their honor is challenged, that triggers the rules and they have to make a roll. Whereas if you challenge a woman's honor in the Icelandic sagas, that's not a thing in the culture.
Right, and yeah, what's so interesting in that is it looks at capability in a positive light and it challenges the players, which means, you know, and this is the thing, it's we don't have to just say everybody is always the same all the time. There are intelligent, useful ways to examine the differences between cultures and between genders, but again, it's something that's still kind of tacking on in the fantasy space. You know, it's not a given by a long shot.
So, I mean, again, this stuff is still problematic, but we're, like, there is progress in the space. I mean, the fact that Wizards put out, you know, an open discussion about the gender of the characters, you know, in upcoming D&D Next and, you know, how they were portrayed is pretty
As opposed to older D&D rule books, which actually have a section about how the male pronoun is used because it is the most accepted, I believe is how they phrase it. There's like, whatever male pronoun, we don't even need to talk about it.
That's the Chicago Manual of Style. I mean, anyway.
Yeah, well, it goes so deep.
So anyway, just real quick, we want to take some questions.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have 5 minutes, so why don't you put your mic out? Why don't you put your mic out? No, I like for other
say
reasons.
Just cut off.
For safety reasons. Adam,
I'm not gonna get to talk.
Yeah, my mic is gonna deal toxic damage now.
So it's also important to address, you guys are coming up with questions, that, you know, D&D isn't dead in its way, and it's, you know, it's been resurrected, and people, like, rather than trying to fix it, people are, you know, designers are embracing it. And its aesthetic, and which is a whole new and great thing. Anyway, you, sir, you might know a thing or two about this. What's your question?
Breakdown. So my question is this. You have presented your history of role-playing games as if there is a progressive movement towards some kind of design, abstract, you know, perfect form. Would you accept the idea that you're being pressed to change the design of role-playing games because the fundamental makeup of the people who play them is changing?
Okay, so I don't have a mic anymore. I'll just talk loudly. So there's an interesting thing. We I do have a mic. but there's this interesting. I like to think of the whole line of modernity thing. It's like classic cars. Like the old things are not broken and busted. They're classic and interesting. And there's that's why we have this slide. There's something great about maintaining them. But there's also, I haven't seen the current version of this slide. But we also have new tools to do new things. Like the idea that the first D&D that came out discovered all of role-playing just seems kind of crazy. Like we've been playing for so long, we're discovering new ways to do things. And we might as well keep on using those to build new things and go further and also maintain the old things that we love because they're great.
So, and I mean, when I design for the people at my table. I design for the players. So I think per force, then yes, right? If those players are not the same as the players in 1974, 1973, 75. So if I am addressing what they're interested in and you know, the way, you know, the direction of play, then yeah, I am being pressured.
And we're also skewing younger. Like that X8 module is as old as I am. Like, so I didn't play it when it came out, obviously. I was not quite reading yet. So, yeah, we design even for who we play with, which means that, yeah, we are a changing demographic.
All right, thank you very much.
Yeah. All right, thanks.
thank you for addressing the elephant in the room, first off. Second, expanding that beyond just the example of the Icelandic tales, how could you expand more on addressing the equality doesn't equate to homogeny?
Oh, man. You seem to have something to say about that, no?
Well, yeah, I mean, the thing is, it's easy, the easiest way out of it is to just say, okay, everybody is the same, and that gender and culture are just color, right? Like, if your character, the color of their skin or their sexual orientation doesn't really matter to the rules, and that's fine if the game's not about that, right? I think you design games to encourage player behavior in a certain way, and not every game can address every point as part of its fictional space. You know, there are lots of great games like Sagas, Monster Hearts. There are games
Dog.
Doggy Dog. For that kind of stuff is what the game is about. So I think it's a question of scope.
For Dungeon World, we deliberately have diverse art. We include people from different backgrounds, genders, etc. But nowhere in the book do we talk about race. There's no place on your character sheet for gender. Just about we go to kind of absurd lengths to not use gender pronouns. And for our game, that's the right thing to do because we're not engaging with it. And then there are people out there who are making these great games that do engage with that. And I think those can also be tricky because to engage with them, you have to portray them in some way. Which I've had people ask me about Sagas, how this incredibly sexist game, you know, it's got different rules for men and women. Why are you a fan of it? And I think it's because it's provocative. Like, you need to present those things to be able to grapple with them.
So, Burning Wheel does not have equality in any shape or form, and I'm okay with that. It's not designed for that, and it has certain points. There are just different roles for men and women. So that's okay, you know. But I think that when you're designing a game, you know, you can explore these spaces, but I think that you need to draw a line, and I think we all need to draw this line and do not exploit or dehumanize a portion of our audience or potential audience ever, no matter of what type they are. I think that kind of exploitation, unconscious or just like, or rationalized or justified, is awful, and I think that we need to call each other out on it. Anyway. All right, last lightning round, quick, fire.
So you guys are clearly focused in life, like skipping the 90s, on fantasy RPGs and fantasy history and so forth. But a lot of these things seem fairly general in terms of the way these mechanics are relevant to role-playing and the way it's changing. Are there things that you think are specific to the fantasy genre with role-playing, or are most of these things directions that you just see across role-playing as a whole?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't say this speaks to role-playing as a whole in any respect. Anytime that, you know, you're starting from those roots, from those pulpy, wargamey roots, and then you're reacting to them and redesigning and fixing, and I mean, you're still in the same space.
Yeah, I mean, it's easy for us to talk about because as long as there's a D&D of some kind, as long as there's a Pathfinder, I think most people will equate that kind of game with role-playing games. If you say, you know, this is an RPG, they're going to think D&D. Obviously, there's tons more stuff that isn't fantasy. We only had an hour, right?
But yeah, we expressly wanted to focus on fantasy. I mean, in fantasy, like the typical story of like kind of power leveling and zero to hero and like, yeah, starting in the muck and rising above and fighting a dragon. And I mean, that's fantasy. Like science fiction role-playing and like is just completely different. You're just dealing with different aesthetics, not only different aesthetics, but just, you know, issues of time and identity and space. Like you just have to use different mechanics to get at that stuff too. Anyway, all right, one more. Keep going. We're gonna go to like kick us out.
Until they kick us out.
You just answered my question with the sci-fi RPG. So
Rocket.
Awesome. Another one down.
You talked about games like old D&D. They don't have rules for basketweaving, what have you, and that's what the game isn't about. Like, there's no mechanics for it. A counterexample I've heard is Dogs in the Vineyard is about making moral decisions, and you can tell because there's no rules about it. Like, that's the part that the players provide. Do you have some thoughts on the difference there?
I think it's as telling leaving a rule out and explaining the space around it as it is making it a fictional mechanic. You know, if you say, these are things that we're not making a mechanic for, like you say, making moral choices, like, dogs would lose its teeth, pun not intended, if if they were to say, okay, when you come to a moral decision, roll a die. On a 1 to 3, you do a good thing. On a 5 or a 6, you do a bad thing. On a 4, you're going to make it up yourself. You know, so leaving a mechanic out is the same as creating it, as long as you're doing it thoughtfully.
And D&D isn't actually really super about combat. Like combat, if you look at the rules in Modve, you are way better off avoiding combat. Like the fact that combat is there is to provide that fruitful void that you don't want to get your ass kicked.
All role-playing games involve moral decisions. All of them. Every role-playing game involves making moral decisions, including D&D, especially D&D. And Dogs of the Vineyard and games like it, I mean, we pointed to some of Vincent's other designs up here, but not Dogs in specific, because it's not a fantasy game. But, you know, Dogs focuses on putting your character in a place where they're going to have to make difficult decisions, but they don't have a morality stat or anything along those lines. They still shoot big guns and stab people with big knives, but they're, you know, in far more morally complex situations, usually. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think so.
Great. Still not kicked out.
Right, I
guess. Keep going, you're good.
Recently joined a new group. They're all in playing Dungeons & Dragons, but they don't actually want to play Dungeons & Dragons. They want to play something more like Burning Wheel, but instead of playing Burning Wheel, they just mod Dungeons & Dragons. And
Dungeon World is $25.
I have those games, and I want them to play those games, but how do I get them to play those games? Because they just clutch Dungeons & Dragons and say, no, this is what works for us, this is what's familiar, this is what we grew up playing.
I don't know, make your own game.
So, to some degree, hacking Dungeons & Dragons is a way to do that. Like, art texts are awesome games, I think they're fantastic, but they're also things you can learn from, and you can start making what you want. Like, that's one of the awesome things about RPGs, is you don't have to buy somebody else's completely finished rules. I think we have some good ideas, I think that, and you've read them apparently, you probably think they're all right. It's a sharing of ideas, and if you can use those things in a way that's more comfortable to your players, that's awesome.
Yeah, there's some psychoanalysis involved, right? Like, you gotta sit down with your players and say, like, why do you like D&D? What about it is fun for you? And can we look for a game that does that, but also does these other things that I want to do?
Torchbearer is $35.
Oh, we're finally underselling Luke. Burning Wheel Gold was like this ridiculous.
Burning Wheel Gold's only $25, but fuck that.
One observation that I wanted you to comment on, and it's totally anecdotal, but in a lot of more traditionally designed things, I found that on the task versus conflict thing, the less central a event is to what the game's about, the more it tends to drift towards conflict and away from task, like talking to people in most editions of D&D, or murder in many White Wolf titles.
Interesting. I don't know that I agree. I mean, I think you're conflating tasks and conflict resolution with abstraction versus a detailed procedure. So, right, the more you get away from the central concept of a game, that often in order to kind of draw a boundary, there might be some mechanics that simply abstract a process. In Pendragon, for example, when you manage your manor, you don't play out every day of managing your manor. There's an abstraction involved. I mean, in Burning Wheel, there's a, you know, abstraction is built into the game where you, if you feel like you just want to quickly resolve something, there's an abstraction mechanic.
Yeah, abstraction of a situation doesn't necessarily mean that it's taking away from the core concept of the game. There's a game called Cold City, where you resolve an entire scene with a single roll. So the characters might talk, they might fight, there might be a chase, and then at the end, you look at the way you've narrated it, roll some dice, and that's it. You've abstracted the entire scene. So I think it really depends on the goal of the game, of the text, right? It's like, how much do you want to focus on any given thing, and how much detail do you want moment to moment versus expanding?
And you can still zoom way out and be doing a task resolution. So we can be looking at, like, managing your manor. I forget the rules from Pendragon, unfortunately, but it could be a very task-oriented system where, like, it's going to tell you how many
stewardship skill.
And it's going to tell you to roll that. It's going to give you the factual outcomes of that. It's going to be like, yes, you keep, you know, people are fed, et cetera, et cetera. Or it could be you, the more conflict style, you manage your manor, what I was thinking about, as well as you can. Your manor is prospering or something like that, which isn't the level of abstraction. It's whether we're looking at your intent and just kind of jumping to this, like, did you manage your manner to what you set out to versus did you manage or what?
Man, it's fucked up.
Did
you do it right or did you fuck it up? And
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
exactly.
It's binary.
Right,
yeah.
It's very binary. And you know, Burning Wheel can get very zoomed in, but and very niche on a particular, like, you know, starting a fire or basket weaving. Sometimes making a basket in Burning Wheel is really important, but it is never ever task resolution. That game, there's no task resolution in Burning Wheel.
Yeah, like we had a conflict to start a fire, and it wasn't about like, are you capable of starting the fire? It's like, does the
do you burn yourself? Did you do it fast enough?
Yeah, they ended up having to burn their holy book because that was the only way they. Yeah.
All right. Thanks. Any other questions? All right. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Well, yeah.